Hey everyone, I hope you've had a wonderful Thanksgiving. I have my sister back here, Sister Kim Thomas, who, if you remember last time she was here, she shared such incredible testimonies of her ministering with the Jewish people. She's got a calling on her life where she ministers to the Jews. And you guys know I'm half Jewish, so I have the same heart for my people, and really it's the Lord's people. So Kim, it's really great to have you back.
Yes, thank you, Anna, and thank you for having me back. It's an honor to, you know, come on your platform and be able to share, you know, the goodness of the Lord, how important it is to reach out to the Jewish people. Only by his grace can we do it, but he has called each and every last one of us to reach out to them.
That's right. Yeah, we are all in ministry. If you are a child of God, we are all evangelists. We are all to go and make disciples.
Amen.
And so we are excited to hear part two of these incredible testimonies that you have walked through and have seen some amazing people that are Jewish touched and moved to believe in their Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach. So you can start wherever you want to. We want to hear more testimonies.
Okay, great. Thank you. One I would like to start with is years ago, a church that I was attending, this particular day, I didn't go to church because they was having a conference. And I just said, well, I'll just stay home. However, I didn't understand why I decided to stay home and not go to the church conference until in the midway timing of when the conference was supposed to have been going on. I got an unexpected telephone call from a young lady that I met there doing, you know how they say, go up and grab your neighbor's hand and pray, gather with four or five people and pray with people. And so just so happened when I was at the church this one particular time, we were holding hands. I don't know why, I just looked at her and I asked her, what's her name? And she said, Hannah. And I said, you Jewish? And she said, no, I'm not. I said, yes, you are. And she said, no, I'm not. And I said, okay, you know, and I left it as that. Well, like a couple weeks later, I will walk up to her and say certain things. And she came out and shared with me, yes, she is. Well, we exchanged numbers. Well, now forward into when the conference came up, I didn't go, but she went. Anna, it was so God ordained. Wow. Because I got a call from Hannah. Hannah called me and said, Kim, I need your help. I'm about to commit suicide. And I said, oh my God, Hannah, get over my house right now. I said, where are you at? She said, I'm at the church conference and I feel like I want to kill myself. And I said, please come to my house now. And she came to my house immediately. Mm-hmm. But then the church was about like 20 minutes, 25 minutes from my house. And when she got here, I began to just like, you know, ask her what's going on. And do you know the enemy was after her to try to take her life just since she was 15. And because during that time, she told me she felt a heavy burden. She used to babysit children. And the dad that would come visit the kids who she happened to be babysitting when she was 15, the dad would take his kids in the back room and molest them. And she found out later that he was molesting. She didn't know this until obviously the kids opened up and shared with their mother. But they found out that the dad ended up getting arrested and he went to jail. Well, now she was 15 and the enemy made her believe it was her. And I say, no, Hannah, that's a lie. Don't you take on that false burden. That's not your fault. Nobody would want to believe when the father has come visiting their children that he taken them in the back room to misuse them to that manner. And so she said that she felt like it was her fault because now the kids were, you know, experiencing certain things that they need counseling or whatever. So I end up praying that off her and, you know, praying that spirit of suicide off her and rebuking it. Do you know God healed her so much? So I didn't know this, Anna. I mean, do you know she went home and her dad came to church the following Saturday? Her dad, her brother, her grandmother. Yes.
They wow, her dad healed. Too?
What? Yes, her dad, her grandmother, her brother, and I believe her mother. And the reason why because they wanted to meet this young lady who prayed for their daughter because they saw a difference. And they, and this is when I met her dad. He said, Hannah came home and from church one particular day, and she was altogether different. And we said, what happened to you? She said, this lady named Kim. He said, so this is why we're here. We want to meet you. We just want to meet you. So he and I exchanged numbers, and he got on the phone and he told me, he said, let me tell you something. He said, my whole family has been in disarray since she was 15. At the time when he was telling me this, she was 22. And he said, and it was breaking up their marriage. Him and his wife had been married for 38 years, and she kept the house in disarray. But he didn't know why, and I never to this day let him know the depth of why, you know, she was in disarray, you know, had the whole family in disarray. But she would, like, you know, like, break out in frustration, anger, you know.
Wait, and that so, was, and so, and the dad didn't know, wasn't it the dad that molested her?
No, she never opened up to the depth of what she told me. Because I guess the mother of who she babysitted the kids, the mother must have confessed all this, and she bottled this in herself instead of going to her parents and saying, remember when I used to babysit? She never opened up. So the enemy took that thing and made it feel like it was her fault. But she come home to her own family, and he said she was just like, she was just unbearable to be with as a parent. You know, that's what her dad told me. And her mom, you know, he would tell me about, he said, this thing was about to break my marriage up for 38 years, you know. And so, do you know what, Anna? The Lord took this experience, and then he asked me to begin to minister to him. He said, because he believes the Lord wants to use me to minister to him. And because he himself was in ministry, and he couldn't see this enemy on his daughter, but he knew something wasn't quite right. And with much prayer, you know, I would just like ask the Holy Spirit to show me, and the gift of counsel, spirit of counsel would come on me. And I began to share with him areas of, you know, like how the enemy was trying to, you know, make him like believe that ministry was more important to ministering to his wife, and how, you know, she was resisting him because of that. And he said that he had started changing from that counsel, and his wife got like changed to the degree that she come along his side in ministry, and she started her own women's ministry, you know. So he was like, wow. So then he wanted me to minister to his son, wow. Stephen. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so Stephen and I, we still close, and I call them from time to time. And Stephen and I think he's like 26, 20, you know, his middle 20s, somewhere around in there, or younger, because he's younger than Hannah. But Hannah's now is, but God had healed Hannah so much. Do you know Hannah is married with two kids now? She's married with one, but one on the way. She probably gave birth, because Stephen just told me back in the summer that she's having her second kid. So that's the depth of how much God healed her, that she was able to grow into her womanhood and serve the Lord with her husband, you know, things like that, and be a mother now. And so I'm quite sure she has been nurturing her children in the ways of the Lord, because I would see them at church from time to time as a family, you know, and I was just like, wow, Lord, look at that. Who would ever thought, had I been at the conference with everyone else, I would have missed that call. You know, I would have been there in the midst of worshiping and praising the Lord. And, you know, mind you, she was around a whole group of people that she could have grabbed on, but she just felt the need to, you know, link with someone that she probably, you know, the enemy might have tried to make you have shame that you don't want to open up while you're yet there in the midst of where the anointing is flowing. You know, not saying that God can't use someone else outside the congregation, but God so chose it like that. And to God be the glory, you know, we experience in the fruit of, you know, her obedience and, you know, reaching out for help and my obedience of, you know, being there. And thank God I wasn't busy doing something else. So, and what in this, Anna, to show you how faithful God is, he turned this whole family around, that he even brought the whole family in to see who is this woman that prayed for my daughter, because he said it changed the dynamic of his home, you know. And then he had me, you know, pray with him, and then his marriage, you know, 38 years, because he said he was thinking about leaving his wife. He couldn't deal with it, but he saw that he was the one at fault.
The enemy was tormenting their family. And it's by the grace of God and it's by the mercy of the Father that he said, okay, enough is enough.
Yes.
Deal with this. Let's cut this out. Deliverance. This is an amazing testimony to her family. There's shalom in the family now. I mean, that is an incredible work of God. How he can just break the yoke of the enemy off of the entire family.
Yes.
That is in disorder.
Yes. And you know what? I was amazed because I say he has five children, and all of them are Bible names like Daniel, Samuel, Stephen, Sarah. You know what I'm saying? Hannah. And I was like, really? So he said, now I want you to pray with my daughter Sarah, because she was going through something in her marriage. I mean, he just was handing, you know. And I know this has been the Lord, and the Lord helped minister through me to Sarah. And, you know, her fall into depression from a marriage that went wrong, you know. So to God be the glory, he says she's much better now and, you know, things like that. So, yeah. So I just want to share that and the importance of, you know, having an ear to hear and being available. You know, sometimes we're not quite equipped, but we know that we can lean on God's wisdom, you know. And he said when we open our mouth, he will give us the words to say. You know, and because I don't know anything about, you know, how do you like counsel someone that's having suicidal thoughts, but the Holy Spirit, you know, gave me the wisdom, you know, to minister to her. And she broke down and cried, and it broke off her, you know, that spirit of suicide broke off her. And she walked out the house, out of my house, set free, you know, and serving the Lord, that her family, her whole Jewish family, you know, knew she was free. And they was like, oh, we coming to church with you. And now look at God. Look at God, the fruit of my obedience, you know, called a whole family in. You know, when one person gets set free, you know, like the whole community would take notice, you know, and they want to see, well, who is this person that say Jesus is the one that used this woman? Let's go see. And then they themselves partake of the fruit of how the Holy Spirit, you know, ministered to me, and the whole family is walking in love and being fruitful in ministry and things like that now.
Praise God. And you know, you nailed it. It's the word available to be an open vessel for the Lord to use us, even in times where, let's say we're going to the store, we're going to work. I've had the Lord do this. I'm literally running to an appointment in the middle of Manhattan, going to show an apartment to one of my clients. And the Lord stopped me and said, this homeless person, I want you to, you know, point out this. And it was so clear. I want you to pray for him. And I said, Lord, I'm like running late right now. I said, and I'm like, don't you know the time? I'm literally running and I will make it on time if I keep running. But so I walked by, I kind of jogged by him, you know, slowed down. And I heard the Lord say it again. You need to pray for him. And I said, okay, fine. So I went back and I prayed for this gentleman. I mean, it was probably about 10 minutes. And he received the Lord Jesus.
Wow.
He had a word for him and he received the Lord right there. And I said, wow. Okay, praise God. And I just started running to my appointment. And by the grace of God, I'm telling you, I don't know if the Lord stopped the time, but I got there right on time and I was running late. Wow. And my client was running late. I mean, he makes it happen. So it's about being available, even if it's inconvenient for us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, his mission is deliverance and freedom for his people. And so just because sometimes it's inconvenient, it is freedom for an entire family.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying you were inconvenient, you know, it was inconvenient, but it just so happened that you were a free vessel and you were available for the Lord to use. And that is so important. It is so important. Well, I would love to hear what other testimonies, because
yes,
I would love to hear testimonies. I'm just like, well, keep going. I want to hear more.
Yeah, but you know, because what it does is it creates an atmosphere and it lifts people's faith up to know that God will do it again. You know, he has, you know, no favorites, you know, God love us all the same, you know, but he just want us to be surrendered unto him, that we will see the fullness of, you know, how much he does favor each and every last one of us, because the Bible does say that his favor follow us as a shield. You know, so when we yield to, you know, his love and his purpose and his plan, we will see all, you know, the promises of God to us are yes and amen. You know, so, you know, what he do for me, he's so much delightful to do it for others. So, yeah. So what I would like to share too, this other testimony, years ago, me and Samuel, you know, Samuel, he and I was invited to a Jewish Passover dinner, and we met a Jewish gentleman, and we exchanged numbers. So we found out that, you know, he was Holy Spirit filled, and we were hanging out together, you know, going to different restaurants. And before you know it, we was like, hey, you know, come to my house, you know, and I knew he was about winning souls and stuff. And one day he came over and me, Samuel and Derek, who's Jewish, we were all standing right here in my dining room praying and stuff. And I was like, okay, so you got any friends? You know, let's see, you know, like go get some friends. So
Jewish friends. Yeah.
Yeah. And so he ended up bringing a Jewish friend over. So I was like, what's his name? He said, Kim, he named some kind of health condition that had his family in disarray. This particular guy family want to put him in a mental institution. And so I said, well, have David come over. And so I told Samuel, I said, come on, I'm going to pull out my prayer shawl. I'm going to throw across the couch. We got to set up the surroundings to make him feel comfortable to know that, you know, it's, we have some Jewishness about us.
Yeah.
You know, so when he walked in, Anna, I kid you not, the prayer shawl was laying right, there's a sofa right here, was laying across the couch, and he was rubbing on it. He said, oh, I see y'all serious around here. Mm. You know, he was rubbing on the prayer shawl. He said, you guys are serious. And but God knew that was God's wisdom. Pull that prayer shawl out, Kim, so he can see. And it like caused his shoulder to like relax when he walked in. Mm. And he said, we were serious. So when I said, come on, y'all, we're going to go to the restaurant, but let's pray. So we all, me, Samuel, and Derek, and David, we all stood around and we started praying. And as we started praying, Derek started crying. And I said, Derek, why are you crying? I opened my eyes because I was the one praying. I said, why are you crying? He said, Kim, the presence of the Lord is so strong in here. I can just feel his love. Wow. And I said, oh, okay, you know. And I wanted to like, come on, let's finish praying, because the focus was David. And I didn't want David to like, you know, like be so overwhelmed that it like scare him and like shut down. And so, but David was like even more, you know, like open, because he saw his Jewish brother who he grew up with was like crying, like this something really serious going on. So me, Samuel, Derek, and David, we all went to the restaurant. And like a couple weeks later, I called Derek and I said, how's David? He said, Kim, you're not going to believe this. He said that something, I forgot the condition, it started with a C. He said that condition is gone. He healed. Yeah. And his parents changed their minds from sending him, calling the mental institution on him. And I was like, wow, you know, that's something. So I said, where's Jack? Jack is his brother. So I said, call Jack over. Because this like, oh, this is getting good. I said, call Jack.
Great God, love it. Jack. Get them all in there.
So he said, David, Derek couldn't come and Jack couldn't, David and Derek couldn't come. So Jack came over by himself. So I said, okay. And I said, Lord, what would you have me to do? He said, have him take Holy Communion. And this is how, yes. And this is now Jack had just come to the Lord by Derek, who they grew up with in his Jewish community. Wow. So I said, okay, maybe I can take him a step further in you, Lord. So I get my cell phone out and put on a YouTube video with Sid Roth. And he was taking Holy Communion with a gentleman and walked the steps through steps, because I couldn't explain it, the depth of how I wanted Jack to receive it and understand it. And especially knowing that Sid Roth is Jewish himself. So I was like, look, he's a Jewish rabbi. And, you know, and Jack was like, oh, okay. I wouldn't grab the elements and stuff. And do you know, he took Holy Communion. Yes, he took Holy Communion right sitting here at my dining room table with me, just he and I. And I was like, amen, Lord, look at you. So then Derek told me, he said, Kim, Jack's parent, his dad was in the hospital with a blood condition. So the Holy Spirit ended up using Derek to go to the hospital to see their dad, Jack and David's dad. And he said he felt very strongly to command his spirit to come out of the father. He felt like it was a spirit that was holding the father hostage to this infirmity. So he said, Kim, I just said, come out of him now in the name of Jesus. And said the father's body, you know, jerked like that. And then he got set free of that spirit. And he said, Jack and David looked at Derek and were like, and they saw the expression of how the dad responded. And he said, Jack immediately said, oh, I'm going to church with you next week.
Amen. I mean, they saw a miracle right in front of them. Their dad delivered. Exactly.
And like the Bible does say that the Jews require a sign.
And
that's what God used with, you know, with Derek. And I'm telling you, me, Derek, and Samuel, we would have some times in the Lord, you know, hanging out. And Derek was always chasing the Jewish people in his community, you know, with the plan of salvation. He would call me laughing. He said, Kim, they run, literally getting out the cars at the restaurant. When they see me coming, he said they start running to their cars because they know he coming. And I was like, oh my goodness, they gonna kick you out of that community if you don't slow down with that. But he was chasing them, and he thought it was funny, you know, that he got known with chasing them to tell them about Jesus. You know.
Amen.
But mind you, and we met him at a Jewish Passover. But God, though man make his plans, God is the one who order our footsteps. So nothing just happened when we are in Christ. And we saw how God strategically, because I think he went up to Samuel and started talking to Samuel first. And that's how, you know, we got connected from then on.
Wait, back that up. So how did you get to a Jewish Passover?
Rabbi Schneider. I don't know. Okay. Yeah.
Anyways, on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so we met him, yeah, through there. And I guess because he comes on television, you know, I believe that was Rabbi Schneider. Yeah.
Love him.
We've been to a couple of Jewish Passover, but I believe it was him. Yeah, and that's how we end up connecting, you know. But God had it, you know, set up like that so we can, like, do further ministry and stuff, you know. Yeah. And so it was a blessing. It was very humbling. And it was a lot of humor in how God was doing what he was doing, you know.
So, you're right. Yeah. You know, miracles, signs, and wonders. That's what the Jewish people want to see. They want to see a sign.
Yes.
And there are, you know, two signs, right? The Jewish man who was healed from his mental disorder, and then the father that was set free. That is so awesome of the Lord to do that.
Yes.
Waiting to show his glory. And show that he's real. Well, let me hear another one. I mean, I know you got a few more.
So another one. Now, Derek's other friend named Marty, he's Jewish. So during this time, how I met Marty was Derek had a brother who, like, ended up passing away after I spoke with him on the phone. I met him on the phone, and he died of some, like, condition or whatever. And so I went to their home, Derek's home, you know, for the service. And after the funeral, we always went to the house. And the Holy Spirit, I'm telling you, Anna, Samuel was there too. The Holy Spirit gave me so much grace and favor to go around the whole house, just ministering to them one by one. And even Derek's mother, Jewish mother, wouldn't receive ministry from him. But do you know that night we stayed till everyone had left? That night when Samuel and Derek went to the store, I sat down and I asked the mother, is there anything you want me to pray with you about? And she said, yes. And she allowed me to pray with her. And I prayed in Jesus' name, and which he was so like, Kim, I'm telling you, I don't think, you know, my mother's ready for this. No, she wasn't ready from him, because you know how the Bible said a prophet is not accepted in his own home, because she saw him as Derek. She didn't see him as the transformed Derek. She know him after the flesh, you know, because, you know, he would tell me they were getting to arguments, but the Holy Spirit graced me so much so that she was very open. Then right before they went to the store, the Holy Spirit led me to one of his cousins. And I don't know exactly what I was saying, but it had to be a word of knowledge. She worked at the airport. And as I began to say certain things, Anna, she started crying. The tears started rolling down her eyes. And I don't quite remember exactly what I was saying, but I knew that had to have been God. When she walked away, she was crying, and Derek looked at me. He was like, wow, you know, because he saw, like, and then I went to another family member and I sat on the couch, was like, hey, you know, I was being casual. And, you know, I was just, my body language was adapting to whatever, like, their body was moving or whatever. And with the teenage daughters, I think they were 14 or 15, they were cousins. And I was like, hey, how y'all doing? You know, and one conversation, conversation led to another, and Derek was looking at me like, they're atheists, you know, like don't try, you know, like he was afraid. But the Holy Spirit ended up allowing me to minister to them to such that they dropped their shoulder and they were open to receive what I was saying to them about the things of the Lord, because I was just talking about the goodness of the Lord and the love of God. You know, I didn't come with like Bible scripture or, you know, condemnation, anything like that. And because of the atmosphere was already a tender moment. You know what I'm saying? Their hearts seemed to be more pliable at that time. And it allowed the Holy Spirit to be able to plant a seed in them that allowed them to sit there and listen. And it was only like a few sentences. And I think we talked for like 5 minutes with the teenager, and they end up like, wow, you know, and shaking their head. And then next thing I know, his friend Marty was in the other living room, and I was like, hey, buddy, what's going on? You know, I switched my code of conversation of how I speak to the teenagers, and I went to him, and his face was all swelled up from, I forgot, something that he ate, and he said he had took Benadryl, but his face was swelled up, and I say, what happened? And he said, you know, he told me what happened. He ate something, and he was on Benadryl, and he was just laying back on the couch, like leaning back, just out of it because of the Benadryl. And I said, hey, can I pray for you? And he looked at me and sure. And as I began to pray, he said, wow, I'm starting to feel better. Wow. Thank you. So I will wait like a couple weeks later. And I say, Derek, where's a guy named Marty, your friend named Marty? He said, yeah, he said how you came over there and pray for him. So I would always on purpose tell him to keep in contact. Call Marty. Tell Marty, get us on the three-way. Let's, you know, let me pray for him. So one day I say, well, when can we meet out for dinner? So Derek said, okay, me, you, and Marty, we're going to meet at the restaurant. So I drove to the mall, and they were waiting in the restaurant for me. And the Holy Spirit told me before I got there, have my friend embroider a hand towel and put the word, it was royal blue, and put it in white, said, pray. And I don't know why. I just felt a desire to get a hand towel for him, and that said, and brought it on there, say, pray. So I said, okay. So when I got there, I said, okay, so what I'm going to say, Lord? And we sitting there, and we make a small talk, but I'm still talking to the Lord. And I say, what I'm going to say when I give him this towel that say, pray. And all of a sudden, I sat there, and he was just small talking. I'm sitting, Derek on one side of me and Marty on the other side. And I'm like waiting on the timing. And I said, you know, what you been into? What you know, this is my way of trying to shake off the nervousness. I said, hey, Marty, what you been into? He said, well, you know, my jewelry business and this and that. And I said, you know what? I just got a gift for you. He said, oh, really? How nice. And I held it up. I said, here, I don't know what's been going on with you, but the Lord said, you've been doing a lot of crying. And I said, and when you start crying, put this on your face and just cry into this towel. You see, it says, hey, pray. And he was like, and he looked at me. He said, oh my God, you're not going to believe this. He said, Kim, I've been doing so much crying because I found out my girlfriend been messing around with my business partner. And I was like, wow. He said, and it broke my heart. He said, you don't realize how much crying I've been doing. And I was like, you have? You know, it shocked me.
Yeah,
but the Holy Spirit knew. I didn't know. I was like, what you have? And he said, thank you. And he grabbed the towel and he put it up to his face. And I looked like, Lord, like we in this big restaurant. He about to break down and cry now, you know, but he got very, very quiet and emotional, you know. And I was like, wow. And do you know, like several months, huh?
That was a special gift from the Father to him.
Yes.
I see your tears.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. And do you know, several months later, Marty moved from Michigan to Florida, and he sent a picture of him on his balcony in Florida and with that hand towel over the that say pray. And he sent it to Derek to send it to me. He said, this towel go everywhere with me.
Wow.
This hand towel. And I was like, look at you, God. Awesome. Isn't that amazing? You know what I'm saying? So it just goes to show you how, no matter how God instruct us, like remember Mary told Jesus, told the people at the wedding, whatever he do, just do whatever Jesus tell you to do, just do it. And so no matter how like crazy it sounds, and because I felt so awkward, you know, but I did it, and because the Holy Spirit knew. And when I said it, I didn't know why, what I was about to say. And I just held it up. I said, for whatever reason, you've been doing a lot of crying. And I said, here, whenever you start crying, put this up to your face. And it's going to remind you to pray, because it said pray on it too. And, you know, and when he opened up, I was like relieved. I was like, oh, you know what I'm saying?
It makes sense. That's so good. I mean, that's such a great word, you know, and not just being open vessels, but just stepping out in faith, just doing whatever the Lord tells you to do. It may not make sense in the moment, mm-hmm. but afterwards it's always like, oh, that's why he had me say that. That's why he had me go there. That's why he had me give this person a towel, you know, embroidered with pray on it. I mean, in the natural mind, it doesn't make sense. And your natural mind will argue against you like, no, Anna, that's really stupid. That's definitely not the Lord. But it actually was the Lord.
And uh-huh. So
that's really encouraging. I know that's going to bless people to really realize that God is in the details. He's not just a God somewhere out there in the universe. He is in the details. He knows the son's heart is broken. And he wants to say, son, I see you. Just pray to me. I want to answer you, but you have to ask me.
Yes, you're right, Hannah. And remember, the Bible says that the Jews require a sign. So that was a sign to him that God heard him. God see his tears. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? That he would even comfort him with this tile, you know?
Wow.
And so it's like, wow, you know? Like
something as simple as a towel.
Yes.
Means so much to him.
And yes.
It's personally made for him. I mean, it's beautiful. We'll talk about one more testimony, then we'll.
Okay. Oh, that time is coming up. Okay. Let me see here.
Wow, we have others you want to share too.
Okay. So you know what? I would like to share this one. Years ago, the Lord led me. I used to do like go from house to house with different prayer ministry, sisters in the Lord and ministry and stuff. And so there's a group of half Jewish. The house would be half Jewish and half the Christian people, but we all as one, as brothers and sisters, like Sid Roth would say, we become one new man. So one particular day, the Holy Spirit put on my husband's heart to invite them to come here. So I invited all the ladies to come here, and I became really close friend. One of them she's gone home to be with the Lord now, a Holocaust survivor. Her name is Paula, and this is all my Jewish sisters here. I don't know. On the end right here is Paula. She's a Holocaust survivor. Myself, I'm in the middle with on the teal top or whatever. Mm-hmm. And the other ones, the taller lady, she's Mama Israel. She lives in Israel. She has a ministry in Israel. And the other two ladies, they're here in Michigan, the three ladies here in Michigan. So, but Paula, she wrote a book called Needle in the Haystack. They sell it on Amazon. And so when she come over here, it was about 30 of us here in my home. I tell you, the Holy Spirit moved so much so. Women were being healed. They were laughing. They were crying, you know. And she stood up and I forgot some song she was singing. And she was really short lady, but she was powerful in the Lord. And it was just a blessing. It was just a blessing. And from her coming here, the Holy Spirit had me stay connected with her. And she and I live like a mile away from each other, like 5 minutes away. And I would go visit her from time to time and just fellowship with her. And she herself started hosting Bible studies at her home and stuff like that. And Samuel would come and I would have her pray over like single men for a wife. And one Jewish gentleman is in ministry now. He come here from Arizona. At the time he was in Virginia, and I had Paula pray that he would receive a wife. The Lord was sending him a wife, and he's in his 50s, never been married. And do you know, God honored her prayer, and he's now married. You know, and when he come here, he say, Kim, I want to meet her personally. You know, and she gave him a book, you know, for me to give to him. And you know, he would call and pray with her, you know, what God was doing with her. And, you know, and then I would go with be over her house. And she always wanted me to go to Wendy's. She said, come on, we're going to get the seniors discount. And she always wanted us to get the free ice cream and a hamburger, you know, and that was our time together. And she wanted me, prefer me to drive her car more so than me drive my car. She said, I want you to drive my car, get out your car and drive my car. And I guess drive her around. She felt safer in her car than my car. But you know what, Anna, the last, right before the COVID broke out, the Holy Spirit say, start spending more time with Paula. I didn't understand why. And I say, hey, Paula, I'm coming over. And she always, you know, treat me like I was literally her daughter. She said, okay, I'm gonna bake you some chocolate chip cookies. And I want you to sit down and eat these cookies. She said, here, eat too. Drink some coffee. And I said, okay. And she said, okay, now come look at a movie. Okay, now take me to the grocery store. But do you know, and I'm so grateful to God that I did that, because I didn't know 2 weeks later she left here. And what happened? She was frying something on the stove and the grease hit her in her face and the nerves. She was in her middle 80s, but the grease like shocked her nerves and it took her out of here. I don't know. It just caused her, I guess, her heart. She stayed alive when she got in the hospital. She stayed alive for like a couple weeks. But she said she was ready to go home.
Wow.
And I was so, so grateful to God that I was obedient to spend that time with her, you know. And when we went to her service, it was such a beautiful, peaceful, homegoing service, you know. And there's much more, but, you know, because of time. But I just wanted to share that, you know. Because I just thought it was amazing that she actually wrote a book about a survivor of the Holocaust, you know, Needle in a Haystack is on Amazon. Mm-hmm. And I still get blessed because, you know, some people want to deny, you know, oh, that didn't happen, as you know, that they mm-hmm. mentioned certain things about that in the media. But I am the first person to say I've walked with a sister in the Lord, you know, had, you know, broke bread together, you know, rode in the car and we looked at movies together and she told me the stories. So, yes. And
yeah, there's a lot of people. Honor. Yeah, mm-hmm. Sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm saying it was an honor of the Lord.
Mm. To spend that time.
Mm-hmm.
What a precious soul. Well, she's with the Lord. So that's mm-hmm. awesome. He rejoices when we go home with him. Praise God. Well, this has been beautiful, Kim. We're going to have to do part 3 next time.
Okay.
Because really, there's nothing like awesome testimonies. It's so encouraging. It builds our faith. Iron yes. sharpens iron, gives yes. us some ideas. And also, again, builds our faith to just step out in faith with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
He instructs
mm-hmm.
us to do something, even if it's like get a towel and, you know, embroider, pray on it. There's such a deep meaning why the Lord is having you do that. It may not make sense, but if you are available for the Lord to use you, there is awesome fruit that you
yes.
will see in your life.
Yeah.
And there's nothing like seeing someone set free, delivered, and receive Jesus and receive the shalom of the Lord, the peace that the family received, because their daughter, which was 15 for 7 years, couldn't understand what was wrong with her. Why is she so horrible? It probably obviously made sense later on when she received the Lord, and I'm sure told her parents eventually mm-hmm. why she was acting out. See, the Lord is about restoration. The Lord is about redemption.
Yes.
He's about shalom. He's about life and life more abundantly. So we give the glory to our God in heaven. If you do not know Jesus, if you're watching this and you're like, this is awesome. You know, I want to see signs and wonders and miracles. Kim, I'd love you to talk them through. Let's say they're just watching this right now and they don't know the Lord, and or maybe they're afraid to step out. We'd like you to pray for them.
Okay, amen. Thank you. Father, we just come together before you. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for your love and kindness. Father, you said that it is not your will that any should perish, but all will come unto the saving knowledge of knowing Jesus Christ as Lord. So, Father, I pray right now for those who don't know you and don't know how to accept you or receive you. Father, I pray to God that they will go before you and say, Father, I ask you to come into my heart, reveal your son Jesus to me, and forgive me of all my sins. And I ask you, Father, that, and I repent of my sins, and I thank you for receiving me. And I ask, dear God, that you reveal your son Jesus to me and even more. And Father, and as they do this, they will know how much you love them, and you have a purpose and plan for each and every one of them. Father, I pray right now, dear God, those who have been weary, Father, and whatever has been going on in their lives, Father, remind them that you love them. Father, let them know, dear God, that you have a plan for them, Father. And as they reach out to you and cry out to you, Father, you will fill them with your joy. You will fill with them with your peace, Father. And those who may be hurting, you will heal them, Father. You will heal their heart. You will heal their emotions, Father. So, Father, I just thank you for your love. Your love, your love, Father, will capture each and every one of them, whatever degree or capacity that they may be hurting in. And so, Father, I thank you for your peace, your grace, and your love. Draw them by your Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.